as well as some perhaps German Lichnitzer sword and buckler work from medieval Renaissance era. The type of sword we're using, is an army sword or a knightly sword from medieval era. There's not a lot of rings or hand guards because they simply didn't have them at that point in history. Instead, we have a simple cross guard which protects the hand. We're often assumed to have some sort of mail gauntlet or at least leather glove if we're actually going to be fighting. But if you're just traveling, you may not have it. This is the most common, you think, type of civilian or unarmored self-defense system. You have your sword at your side, your buckler here or somewhere else on your belt, and if you got accosted by a ruffian, you could pull them both out fairly quickly. You might be on a hook, they have little buckler hooks, so they hang on their belt, grab it right off. It's also called a buckler, which is a swashbuckling. Swashing the buckler was like, hey, you want some? Alright, so the sword is fairly cutting, depending on the type, but it also has usually a weird point to get through the chainmail of the era. So it can both cut and thrust, and it's straight and sturdy blade. So we're going to use both cuts and thrusts in the system. Let's get back into our stance again. Shoulder width, turn forward. Other foot should be on our toes. Good. The first ward we're going to show following the manuscript is called underarm or first ward. Yep. And basically, you can hide your sword a little bit under the visor. The hand can be facing out like this to help facilitate. It's facing down depending on what you're going to do. Okay? So we're right foot forward in this stance. You can also do this left foot forward. This seems a little bit awkward from this side, but you can unwind it easily too. Usually it seems to be shown with the buckler in front of the hand, but some of the manuals seem to show it on the side as well. So either way, it's still accurate. I like to have it in front a little bit so that they can't throw just a quick shot in my hand. From here, it's the most obvious strike you can do. From rising underarm to their hip, to their leg, to their head, right? So underarm is any strike coming from below. If you do it without the buckler, it would just be coming up like this. Hopefully with a step, right? Either an advancing step or a passing step. Make sense? But if we have a buckler, we want to try to follow just behind the hand because we don't have a guard on this hand, right? So he's going to get chopped off and end the fight quick. So as we're coming out with the strike, we want to follow with the buckler. So the sword can lean a little bit, and the buckler should be following right after. Sometimes if you try to do both at the same time, having your strike a little bit. You can do it, especially if you're going into an advance. But if you're striking, I like to tweak the sword a little bit and then you can cover the hand there. Okay? So there's another defense that comes out of this. It's called falling under the sword. I like to think of it as sweeping side from underneath the sword. So if you set your sword there, you straight like this. If they're threatening us and we don't do anything, she can just come in and stab my face. Oh, I don't want to do that to happen. So as she's threatening me with that point, I'm going to sweep aside from underneath. I'm going to get into an overbound position, and then I'm going to proceed. So falling underneath from this position is the most common counter in the one training. So from here, we're going to sweep out and over the top a little bit. And then we're going to follow in here with a thrust, which should be having our buckler ready to hit their hand or guard against their buckler. We can actually strike their shield at that point with our shield, which is called a shield strike, to bind up their buckler. So Karen, please hold on for a second. So he's going to be attacking directly right here. So he's his half shield. And here, I'm going to get that sword out of my face. So I fall underneath it, shield strike, stab, cut, whatever I need to do. Make sense? So let's practice that motion. We're going to be our underarm guard, a little bit advanced. We can even be almost here with it. We're going to be attractive. So from here, we're going to fall under. Now pretend you're striking their shield. Stab them in the face. Good. Attraction. Excellent. One more time.
So,
fall under.
Yeah.
So I want to be a little bit quicker this time. All you're going to do is fall under and step on the under. Ready? Go. Get that buckler up there in front. Yep, it's going to be hitting their shield or binding up their sword while we leave it to strike them, right? Either if you can get both their shield and their sword, but either come up together. If I can get both of them knocked, I'm in a great position. If I only get a sword knocked, that's still safer. Especially on this side, if I want to move that buckler, I'll try and punch you. If I'm on this side, I'll just here a second. And I bind it's just a shield, his sword is more free. Right? So you have to be aware of that. So we have the concepts of falling under the blade, which is a sweep of the blade to bind it, followed by a shield strike, and a stab or a cut to the face, whichever one's more convenient. The most common blow shown in 133 is called a nutchen. If you come forward for a second. It seems to be, if I've got the sword down over this way, they think, and that doesn't have to be necessarily like this, it could be going into their face sideways. They never show the sword on the side, so it could be coming into the face anyway. But basically, I found the blade down, so I come up with the sword. Make sense? So let's try that. And then just go under, so I'm going to over, and strike up in the face. Boom. Get that buckler in front on that rear face. They're at. Wherever their sword or shield is at, that's where the buckler goes. Good. One more time. Here. Strike out. Boom. Boom.
Okay.
Good.
So, if I will, like women's guard, same with women's guard as far as your
sword. So we're back in underarm. We're going to fall under the sword. Now stand your buckler and attack the face.
Back.
So one more time. It's kind of a complicated motion. Falling under, finding the sword, and then striking the face and go to step. We need to.
Hold it like this. Actually, one method. Yeah.
Let's actually try that with the partner. And good. Pair off. Here. One person is going to stand in half shield, like this. First of all, let's try. One person is going to stand in half shield, the other person is under arm, with stand in arm. We're going to fall under the sword. Now you're going to shield strike, and then nudge.
Switch.
Yep. Boom. Make sense? And slowly throughout right now, right? So we've gone over underarm, falling under the sword, shield strike, nudge it, and have to happen more together. So it should be more like if you come up here again, he's going to be in half shield, which is the counter. Counter work.
Here.
A little bit higher. Here to there. This is called half shield. What should he do before I get to that point?
This is why when you're sparring, you're fighting.
What should he do? Move into it. Jump on it. With your sword. That's it. You see what he's done? He's overbound me first, right? He knows that I'm going to come over from this side most likely because I'm in this stance. So he's gotten close enough that as I start my movement, just jump on it. Ready? Boom. He's already skill striking me, so he can nudge me or stab me, whichever one he needs to do. Make sense? So, go ahead and hit your guard. I'm sorry, you're an underarm. So he's an underarm, I assume, half shield. He doesn't do anything, he jump on it, he starts to do the motion. I don't want to worry about the sword first, even though he's got a buckler. He starts to buckler down, so he can come around instead. Make sense? So, the short circuit is under, is falling under. We just jump on it.
It helps us
search. And then make our move. Make sense? Let's try that other part.
Also, the shortest distance is
you're gonna start falling under, and he's gonna jump on your attack. Oh.
Now, see how you got a little tangled up, but I want you to overbind her more on this side if you can. But
actually, this is.
That's it. See, you feel vulnerable there? All right. I'm Adam Simmons with the Phoenix Society of Historical Swordsmanship, and that was the first two plays from 133 Manuscript. Thank you.